Jesus, there is nothing like. To heaven's flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Yeah, holy, holy, holy is our God Almighty, who was and is and is to come.
With all creation I say praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything and I will adore you. I will.
All right, I want to continue with our theme of Welcome to the Jungle. If you haven't been with us, we've been looking at the book of Daniel, comparing what Daniel and his friends went through being taken captive in Babylon to where the American Christian church is right now in our own American culture. And thinking about tonight's message, probably the best sermon I heard last year was delivered by a young pastor from Santa Rosa, California, commenting on the current conditions. He was actually teaching the book of Daniel, and he said some very prophetic things. He said, "Do you feel the shifting tide in our country like I do? A confusion like the Tower of Babel? With what's coming, American cultural Christianity, as practiced, will quickly become irrelevant. We will need a worldview that equips us to survive and thrive in the midst of a Babylonian culture." He said, "Our nation is transitioning, and most don't know how to live in a world like this. We will have to get better at living in conditions that are not Christian," which is my theme for tonight. Our current culture of American Christianity is largely unprepared for the escalation of political persecution that is coming to our door. We are unprepared, frankly, because we as preachers and teachers, pastors and leaders, have done not enough teaching in the American church on the subject of suffering for the sake of the gospel or being persecuted for righteousness' sake. So I'm entitling tonight's message, Prepared for Persecution. Prepared for persecution. You know, when you grow up, I mean, I'm older than most in this room, and this is the first time in all my, next month I'll be 77. And I've never experienced the anti-Christian spirit in America that I'm sensing now. Trust me, this is as bad as it's ever been in my lifetime. I believe in the history of our country, and it's going to get worse before it gets better. I'm believing it'll get better. And God can do a miracle. Come on, he could turn it around overnight. But what if he doesn't? You see, in a culture like this, pastors and leaders feel like, well, why should I teach on preparing for persecution? I mean, it's such a bummer. Why should I talk about suffering for the gospel's sake? I mean, hey, we're Americans. You know, we're into Jesus will bless me and keep me and prosper me. And so I suppose there hasn't been much felt need for it. But really, we're not preaching the full counsel of God if we didn't preach it even in good times, because it's promised. Jesus, the last of the Beatitudes, the eighth one, if you were with us for the year we taught Sermon on the Mount, there are eight Beatitudes. The last one is the least popular and least quoted, but it is one of the Beatitudes. It's where Jesus said in Matthew 5, 11, 12, "Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who came before you." Notice he did not say, "Blessed are you if they persecute you." He said, "Blessed are you when they persecute you." Jesus prepared his disciples for persecution by promising them to expect it. He said the same thing in John 15, verse 30. "Remember this word that I said to you. A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. The Apostle Paul taught the same thing to his disciples in the last letter that he wrote on this earth, the little epistle of 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12. He said, he was talking about all that he had suffered for the gospel. And then he closes that little portion in verse 12 by saying, yes, and all who will live godly will suffer persecution. If that's not a preparation for the persecution, then I'm not reading my Bible. From the lips of Jesus, from the lips of the Apostle Paul. And it's my personal opinion that we American pastors don't preach on it because, first, it's not a seeker-friendly sermon subject. You know, you can put the sign out on the meeting. Be with us next week for the sermon, prepared for persecution. Boy, that's a sure audience killer. I mean, that's sure to eliminate any first-time visitors, most likely. But secondly, we don't talk about it because up to now, we haven't really had much persecution to suffer over. But all that is changing because the Antichrist forces of the Marxist socialists now run the government. Dr. David Reagan tells us what comes next. He said, socialism always results in religious persecution. Socialism always results in religious persecution. Since socialists, by their very nature, are not religious, and in fact, they hold religion in contempt. They are humanists who believe in man rather than in God. That's a strong statement. He's basically saying if you have a socialist government anywhere, you're going to have religious persecution. And I submit to you the record of history. Look at any nation where it's come to power, and you'll see the suppression and persecution of the church, whether it's Russia, Cuba, China, Venezuela, Italy, during World War II, any place. And now we will see it here. Any nation stupid enough to vote in socialists will have to endure religious persecution as a result. And they make socialism sound so good. It's deceived so many people. They often use Christian terminology, but they never tell you their true agenda. It all sounds so Christian. Well, let's share. Everybody needs to, you know, you got too much, give it to somebody else. And of course, that's Christian, you know, give it to somebody. But they say, no, you have too much. I'm going to take it from you and give it. That is not Christian. Their real goal is something called totalitarianism. The great Ludwig von Mises. Oh, I love that name. What's your name, son? Ludwig von Mises. And just immediately, he has credibility. I mean, anybody named Ludwig von Mises. No, he was a brilliant sociologist, political writer. He defined totalitarianism as the subordination of every individual's whole life, work, and leisure to the orders of those in power and in office. It is the reduction of man to a cog in an all-embracing machine of compulsion and coercion. It forces the individual to renounce any activity of which the government does not approve, and it will tolerate no expression of dissent. Now, folks, we are already seeing the birth pangs of this kind of government. Actually, we began to get a glimpse of it a year ago as they used the coronavirus crisis as an excuse for virtually invading every area of our lives with new controls, whether it was face mask mandates, lockdowns of schools, businesses, churches, you name it. They told us where we could go, not go, and how many could be there when we arrived. The shocking thing is that most American Christians went along with those mandates without a whimper. Many even voted to put the perpetrators of those policies into power. Panty-waist pastors went silent. Deceived disciples voted for the pro-abortion party, and some didn't vote at all. The Spirit of God, I believe, was so grieved over the pathetic performance of the church in the last election. That's why he directed me to do the series we started a few weeks ago on holy violence, where Jesus said the violent take the kingdom by force. He's not talking about physical violence, but Jesus said there's a spiritual kind of attitude that's required to get into the kingdom and advance the kingdom. And if we don't have that, we won't see it. The Lord told me to remind the church we're in a spiritual battle with evil itself. Evil itself. I'm not calling these people personally evil. I'm saying, I've told you over and over, we do not war against flesh and blood. This is a spiritual warfare. There are spiritual forces driving these people, controlling these people. And we just haven't, we have been up for the battle. Larry Alex Taunton said, C.S. Lewis called Christianity a fighting religion. Think about that. He said, these days, such a statement strikes a somewhat absurd note with a generation that has never known war, privation, or suffering in defense of anything, much less suffering in defense of noble ideals. What he's saying is we've just had it pretty easy. Up to now, being a Christian in America has been a piece of cake, but it's changing. And I believe the book of Daniel is a model. If you haven't been with us, we've been pulling some prophetic parallels from Daniel's captivity in Babylon, comparing it with American Christians' experience in our own country. A review, if you weren't here, the first test in chapter 1 was a test at the table. It was very private. It was over something as simple as something to eat. As he was offered the king's meat and wine, and verse 8 says, but Daniel purposed in his heart he would not defile himself with the king's meat nor his wine. And we showed you the spiritual principle that was critical to the life of Daniel and to the rest of his victorious story. Living under several different Babylonian kings and getting promoted at every level. And I believe it all traces back to something he did in his heart before things got worse. He started with a little private victory with very few people around. And he passed the test and got a promotion. But as we move on over into the book of Daniel, we discover that what began as a simple test of private faith moves into some seasons of public persecution. Then this is one of my themes. Living under a Babylonian political system will always expose the people of God to progressive levels of persecution. Did you hear what I just said? There will be progressive levels. The little tests we've had up to now have been just over nuisances like wearing a face mask or can't get our kids in school. We deal with that pretty much privately. But as the days to come, here's a word from the Lord. We will need the Holy Spirit to help guide us on choosing our battles. Because there are going to be many things come against us, but we need to pick our fights. You understand what I mean? You can't go out and just
Start fighting everything. Not every government regulation coming at you will require resistance. For example, Daniel and his friends were captured by Babylonian forces and taken into a Babylonian culture. They did not take up the sword. They did not fight. They did not resist. Basically, because Jeremiah the prophet said, this is God's punishment of you. Don't fight it. Just go along with it because God is not happy with Israel. And it may shock you to find out God ain't happy with the American church. We're waking up to that. How many of you know God's in charge? Not every government regulation coming at us will need resistance. They didn't resist being taken into Babylon. They didn't resist when they changed their names. Remember, they gave them new names. Each of the four Hebrew children had names that contained the name of God in one form or another, Jehovah. But they renamed them with names that all contained the name of their major god, Bel or Murdoch. Murdoch. So they didn't resist that, but they did resist this matter, this test at the table, eating the king's meat, because that would have been a direct violation of a clear commandment of God. See, there's no commandment of God that says you can't get punished, chastened by the Lord, can't get taken into temporary captivities. No commandment against that. People call you names. Want to rename you? How many of you know they're renaming Christians now? I mean, I have to turn on CNN to learn that I'm a white supremacist. Gee, I didn't know I was. I mean, I'm the problem. People that look like me. But that's not anything you need to resist. I don't like it. But there will, I mean, you hear what I'm saying. There will come moments when the Holy Spirit will have to give us guidance on what will need resistance. And the message will be, at some point, we will have to resist the king's commands. And when that time comes, I'm telling you ahead of time, you're going to have to be willing to take a risk. Because when you get to this next level, beloved, it will cost you something to stand for the Lord. The first test was in private in chapter 1. The risk not so great. Things didn't work out. All they would have probably done if they'd taken them out of the palace and put them on the work cruise. But all that changes in chapter 3. I'm not going to read all these scriptures because I don't want to wear you out. But chapter 3 of Daniel. In chapter 2, Daniel interprets the king's dream that none of his astrologers could interpret, and he gets a promotion. But the king interprets the dream as magnifying himself, and he goes out and builds an image to himself. In verse 1 of chapter 3, Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold. The scholar says it was an image of himself. 60 cubits high, 6 cubits wide. What's that, about 60, 70 feet? 6 or 7 stories? Gold? 90 feet. Thank you. It's my scholar back there. 90 feet. Think about it. Was that an 8-9-story building? They put it on a plane, a flat place. So how many of you know you could see that thing from? And then he gathers, in verses 2 and 3, all the political and judicial powers in the land for a dedication ceremony. And he says, and the king sent word to gather together the satraps, the administrators, listen, the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the judges, the magistrates, and all the officials to come to the dedication of the image he had set up. And they stood before the image he had set up, and in verses 4 to 6, and then a herald cried out. Here's their version of the mass news media. He cried out, To you it is commanded, O peoples, nations, and languages, that when you hear the sound of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, and psaltery, in symphony with all kinds of music, you shall fall down and worship the golden image that the king has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast immediately into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. You see, when you live under a Babylonian political system, sooner or later, the crisis will be over what will you worship? Are you going to worship the man-made image that man sets up? Or are you going to stay true to God? And if you don't worship to stay true to God, there's a risk. And in this case, it's your life. Ralph Waldo Emerson once said, what we're worshiping is what we're becoming. We become what we worship. That's why I preached last week, don't let this world system get into you. It's okay to be in the world, but not to let the world in you. Because it's very seductive. And it demands worship, just like God does. So the world system is piping a tune out there. They're making a certain sound, and they're demanding that we dance to the music. As Sly and the Family Stone once preached. And notice most of the people go right along. Verse 7. So at that time when all the people heard the sound of the horn, flute, harp, and lyre, and symphony with all kinds of music, all the people, all the nations and languages fell down and worshiped the golden image the king had set up. Except for three. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Verses 8 and 11. I'm not going to read all this. So they didn't. Everybody's falling down. Everybody's dancing to the music, falling down, worshiping, except these three guys. And they get ratted out. Some of the astrologers went to the king and informed on the Jews. They said to the king, didn't you issue a decree everybody had about them? You know, that these guys over here are not doing it. How many of you know we're already seeing that? We got people in our country snitching on brothers and sisters, fathers and mothers, reporting to the government. They didn't have a mask on. Get the mask, police. They're at the mall. Get the mask, police. We laugh. Oh, ho, ho, ho. He, he. But if it comes to your door. So, of course, they said in verse 12, but there are certain Jews whom you've set over the affairs of the province of Babylon. These three men, they have not paid regard to you. They didn't serve your gods or worship the gold image you set up. So here's what we have today. The party in power is playing a tune and making out, marking out those who refuse to bow down. Did you know they're making lists? Have you heard that? They're coming right out and saying it. They're making lists of Trump supporters, people who didn't go along with their agenda. They're making lists of businesses. They're making lists of pastors. They're making lists of people who speak out. How many of you know they're monitoring Facebook? They're monitoring the social media now. What do you think that's all about? It's the same thing. Algorithms are being used to identify those who dare to defy the messaging of the fake news media. And man, are they mad when you don't. In Daniel 3, 13, 14, and Nebuchadnezzar, when he heard this, in rage and fury. See, I always wonder, why are they so angry? Why are they so mad? I mean, come on. Hey, dude, I didn't like the last president, but I sure wasn't angry at him and running him down. And what is wrong with these people? The spirit of Babylon is on them. So when you don't go along, it makes them mad. He had rage and fury, and he gave the command to bring these three boys before him. So they brought them. And he said to them, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods, nor worship the gold image I've set up? And he gives them one more chance. He says, now if you're ready now, when you hear the sound, if you're ready to worship, good. But if you don't, you will be cast immediately into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And who is the God who will deliver you from my hands? So this is happening today. Those in authority are threatening the people of faith. Don't think it's not coming. I pray we can answer like they did. And so they answered the king. Oh, Nebuchadnezzar, we don't need to think about an answer concerning this matter. If you'll do that to us, throw us in the furnace, our God whom we serve, listen to this, is able to deliver us from the furnace of blazing fire, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. That's a statement of faith. But you hear the rest of it. But even if he doesn't, be it known to you, O king, we are not going to serve your gods, nor worship the golden image you have set up. And what follows, we all know. I'm going to give you the rest of it because we preach on how they were delivered from the fiery furnace. It's one of the greatest miracles in the Bible. How many of you know you got a furnace heated seven times? I mean, it was a big furnace. That was one you can stand up and walk in. I can't imagine the size of this thing. So hot that the men who threw the boys in died from the fire just getting close enough to throw them in. And they're in there walking around. And the king said, what's going on here? Hey, I thought we only threw three men. I see four men walking around. And the fourth one looks like the Son of God. But the story is great. But I'm just saying, what I'm after here is to show you how persecution escalated from the private to the public, from maybe a small penalty to your very life. And the position that these take is a model for you and for me if we're going to serve God in this hour. Because when it gets tough and it comes to this point, and it could, then we ought to be able to say, we don't need to think about this. We've already made up our mind, O king. If you throw us in there and carry out your threat against us, the God we serve is well able to deliver us, and he will deliver us, O king. But even if he doesn't, we will not bow down. We will not serve your gods or worship the image you are making. Praise God. And then, of course, they get promoted again. In chapter 248, it says, thus the king promoted Daniel and gave him many gifts. Daniel got promoted at the end of chapter 1. And here at the end of chapter 3 in verse 30, it says, and then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. But what if God hadn't delivered him? What if he hadn't? How many of you know millions of Christians have been killed by socialist governments? Millions. Could God have delivered him? He's God. Does he always? No. So you got to make your mind up now. How many of you know I'm talking about being prepared for persecution? These are things you settle in your heart ahead of time. You don't wait till the Nazis are at your door. I love that ending. I mean, Peter was crucified. Paul was beheaded. Stephen was stoned. Could God have delivered him? Yeah. Did he? No. How do you know what he'll do with you? You see, that isn't even the issue for the Christian. The Christian isn't whether he delivers you or not. The issue for the Christian is, will I stand for God in the midst of an alien culture? Our God is well able to deliver, but even if he doesn't, we're not going to serve your gods or worship the image you've set up. So this needs to be our position on persecution. Let me make three points as we move toward the conclusion. We are now living under a Babylonian system of government where there will be an escalating persecution of people of faith. Put it down. I said it, I'll stand by it. I wish I could prophesy something happy, like many do, and raise false hopes, like many have. And God is sovereign. Listen, folks, I'm going to say it again. God could turn this around. I mean, in one day, he could turn the whole thing around. But the issue won't be a problem. You know what? I'd be glad to get up here and say, I was wrong. But if I'm right, I will be able to stand before God and say, Lord, I did everything I could to get your people ready for what's coming. I did everything I could. And this is what I'm saying. We are living under this kind of government now. And persecution will escalate for people of faith. Number two, the testing of our faith will move from private to public. The risk or cost of disobedience or resistance will become greater. And finally, the prudent person will be prepared for the persecution and he will pass the test of faith. As I say right now, folks, what we're suffering right now is minimal and private. I mean, I suffered the other day at the gas pump. 60 cents a gallon, at least, since the election. Thank you, President Biden. I mean, that's not exactly persecution, but I don't like it. What if it goes to $5 a gallon? Mask-wearing mandates are a pain, but it's, you know, our kids can't go to school, but they'll get back one day. But what will we do when these little private persecutions go public? What will you do if the vaccine becomes a mandate? Have you given any prayer to that? Now, again, I'm not saying taking the vaccine is a sin. Don't go out of here and say it. Listen, you say, well, are you taking it? I don't think so. I don't think it'd be a sin if I did. I don't think it's a sin if you did. But I tell you what is a sin, when they make that a mandate to where you can't buy or sell or get into, do your business without it, that is a sin from them. What will you do when your school allows boys in your little girl's locker room? What will you do as a business owner if ESG scores become national policies? Does any of you know what an ESG score is? This is what they're creating in the world of banking and commerce. It's a set of standards used by socially conscious investors to screen potential investments. Now, here's how it works. They look at your company's policies as to who you serve, what you say on your website, what you say on Facebook, Twitter. If it doesn't line up with the party line of the golden image in Washington, they lower your ESG score. If you're politically correct, you go along with all the policies, you buy into everything that they put down the pipe, your ESG scores goes up. Why does it make a difference? Because they're grading everyone. They're choosing winners and losers. And they're saying, if your ESG score isn't high, you won't be able to get a loan. Because the bank is totally in on it. And when they look at your score, they say, you know, you don't hire enough black people. You don't hire enough white people. You don't, you said something on Facebook. Your company policy has God in the motto. I mean, how many of you understand what I'm saying? What are you going to do if that becomes national policy? Only businesses with high ESG scores will qualify for investment. Conservative-owned businesses with low scores may go out of business. What will you do when they come for your guns? What will you do when preaching from the Bible is banned as hate speech? What will churches do when they're required to hire gay people? That's in the bill that's right now in the Congress, already passed one house. What will we do if they close down our churches? I can almost hear some who hear this sermon accuse me of gloom and doom, and they'll say, God will never let it get that bad. Beloved, I never thought he'd let it get this bad. I was so sure Donald Trump was a shoe-in. Man, I was like, I was a little nervous. I wasn't taking it for granted. I voted, I prayed, I gave, I encouraged people. Not because of his personality, God knows, but because of his policies. I never, and I heard Christians say, God would never let that other guy in the White House. God would never let them take the Senate. God would never let them take the House or keep the House or whatever. Well, he let all of that happen. So here we are. Proverbs 22:3 says, a prudent person foresees danger and takes precautions. The simpleton goes blindly on and suffers the consequences. So are you a prudent person or a simpleton? All right, let me give you three practical things quickly that can prepare us for persecution. Purpose in your heart not to be defiled by this world. Make up your mind to take a stand for the Lord. And recognize the risk and count the cost and prepare for any persecution that may come. Purpose in your heart. Daniel purposed in his heart. That was the core of everything. Where's your heart before God? How sold out are we to the Lord? Because it will take a complete commitment to Christ to resist the pressure that could well come. Make up your mind. Boy, I tell you what, I've never seen so many double-minded people. Just wishy-washy, back and forth. Peter said something very interesting over in 1 Peter 1:13. He said, gird up the loins of your mind. Gird up the loins of your mind. The Bible scholars tell us a reference to, like, if you were going to go run or if you were going to do some heavy work, you know, they wore those long robes and togas and whatever. And so if they were going to do anything, they would gird that up so they could be really free to do what they needed to do. That was the imagery they think he had in mind. Another version of the Bible on that verse says, prepare your minds for action. Be ready. The commentator Albert Barnes said the meaning here is that they were to have their minds in constant preparation to discharge the duties or to endure the trials of life in the same way they would prepare for work, for a race, or for a conflict. The days will soon be here when neutrality is not going to be an option. A true disciple will be forced to become a dissident. Dissident. I looked it up. It says a dissident is a person who opposes official policy, especially that of a totalitarian state. It's like a week ago, I couldn't spell dissident, and now I are one. This is where you'll find yourself. Get used to it. I'm a dissident, and you know what? I'm proud of it. I will oppose official policy, especially policy of an authoritarian state. For many years, the great Rush Limbaugh spoke for us. I really grieve when we lost Rush. I liked his show. I listened. I thought he was really smart, said things with humor. I miss him. But you know what the Lord told me? He said, my people have sat back on the pews and let Rush speak for them. Now he's out of the picture. My people need to stand up and speak for me. It's almost like
God's taken our props out from under us. You know, Donald Trump was a real, almost like a placeholder for us. I mean, God used him to stop something that was bad and even turn it to go the other way. And I think many Christians just sat back and said, we got President Trump. He's going to fight our battles for us. And hallelujah, we got him, but we're going to be fine. And oh, if we don't have him, oh, we're in trouble. Well, we don't have him. Oh, that Rush Limbaugh, you know, when he speaks, it's like I just, that's what I'm thinking. That's what I'm thinking. Beloved, you better stop just thinking God's word and start speaking God's word, because that's what America needs. Come on. Boy, you're quiet. Okay, Alex Stoughton says, too many Christians today are risk averse. This is the third point. Be prepared. Too many Christians today are risk averse. They prefer the safety of the Family Life Center to engaging the culture in any way that might cost them something. God forbid they might sacrifice their wealth or comfort, endure the social media mob, or be excluded from the neighborhood barbecue. He says the highest calling of a Christian is not to be civil. I hope you hear this. This political correctness is from the devil. Our highest calling is not to be civil. It is to be salt and light, to stand strong for one's faith in Jesus Christ and push back at a culture that, in the words of Isaiah 55:20, calls evil good and good evil. But today that's seen as divisive, unloving, bigoted, or intolerant. This is because the church has confused Christ's command to love others with being civil, as if that were an attribute of God, which it isn't. As a consequence, a superficial, self-righteous, good-for-nothing pietism has displaced authentic Christianity in many of the roughly 400,000 American Christian churches. Think of it, 400,000 American Christian churches. And then he says, this doctrinal malpractice has given us a generation of men, Christian and otherwise, who are what C.S. Lewis called men without chests. Men without chests. No gumption. I'll close with two things from this pastor in South Africa, Chris DeWitt, Hope Central Church in Highlands, South Africa. He closed the message on Daniel with this. There's a charge to his congregation, and I think it's a good one for us tonight as we close. He said, where is the Lord calling you to take a stand that involves a risk? I ask you tonight, every one of you, this is a prayer. Lord, where are you calling me to take a stand that will involve some risk on my part? It could be very private in your finances, your relationships, your finances. It could be speaking up for Jesus in a situation where that might be taken very badly. Ask God and close with this prayer. Lord, what would you show me? I don't want to blend. I don't want to assimilate. Prayerfully pick something, no matter how small, and name it as such, an area where you've been tempted to compromise, but now you're going to say, no more. No more. That's pretty good. You know, when I got saved, I'll tell you this story. When I got saved, I was working for a very dynamic, charismatic, powerful personality boss at a radio station. I was in the radio business at that time. And he was about 6'4", big, deep voice, red hair, and a temper to match. Boy, when he was in a bad mood, and he would just, you know, like, Cliff, you got a phone call, and he would say, tell him I'm not here. He's not here. Cliff, you got a somebody's on the phone here. Tell him I'm out to lunch. He's out to lunch. Then I got saved. And I didn't even think about it. And one day he told me to lie for him. He said, tell him I'm not here. And I told the person on the phone, I said, he said to tell you he's not here. He went ballistic. He cussed me out. I'm telling you, when he got off that phone, he let me have it. But you know, I walked out of there feeling so good. I took a stand. It was a little stand. Come on. It was risky. It could have cost me my job, I guess. I sure got a tongue lashing. But that's just what I'm talking about, folks. Let's prepare for what's coming. Amen? It never hurts. Lord, help us to be that people. In Jesus' name, and all the saints said, amen. Praise God.